True Crime Brewery contains disturbing content related to real-life crimes. Medical information is opinion based on facts of a crime and should not be interpreted as medical advice or treatment. Listener discretion is advised.
How did you view yourself before coming to prison? What sort of person do you believe you were?
Good person. Pretty much would give you the shirt off my back. Never met a stranger.
Tell me about your relationship with Zahra.
We hit it off right from the bat.
What did you like about Zahra?
She had spunk about her. She never gave up. Always had a smile on her face. Always.
Did you have a close bond?
Very close. She called me Mom. And I treated her like she was my own child. She got no different treatment than my other kids did. Actually, my other kids got jealous of her. They
really?
Said I treated her better.
Why would a school teacher give her her own personal cell number and say to her, if you ever need me, call me?
That right there was out of protocol. I even said something to the principal about that. Me and Adam went because that was against the rules. They should not have ever done that.
Why did you sign a piece of paper here that admitted that you have a history and a pattern of physical, verbal and psychological abuse of Zahra?
I never signed that paper.
You did? There's your signature.
Okay, somebody's had me sign something I shouldn't have signed because that's not so.
That's not your signature?
That's
along with your attorney. That's not your signature.
That's my plea bargain, right?
Yes, but you signed that you accept that you had a history and a pattern of physical, verbal and psychological abuse of Zahra.
That was in with my plea bargain. Yes,
so you
ma'am.
You signed it?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Tell me about the day that Zahra died.
She was laying on her bed and I said, Zahra, are you okay? And I walked over to the bed and I said, Zahra. She still didn't move. I put my hand on her and I could tell she wasn't breathing. And my first thought was CPR, so I immediately started CPR. I worked on her for probably about 30 minutes and couldn't get her back, begging the whole time for God not to take her. Right then, I should have called 911, but I got scared.
Of what?
I didn't know what to do. I've never been faced with anything like that.
If you'd done CPR, you'd dial 911, wouldn't you?
Most people would have, yes.
Of course, the evidence doesn't show that what you're saying is the truth.
It does to a point, but there's a little bit.
Not even to a point. The phone records show that on the day the body was disposed of, the day that you told police it was disposed of, there were something like 9 calls, and many of those calls were to Adam. Why would you call him if he's right beside you?
He was calling my phone. I wasn't calling his because he kept losing my phone.
No, you were calling him.
I wasn't calling him.
He wasn't with you, was he?
Yes, ma'am.
I don't think so. That's the truth, isn't it?
No, ma'am.
Did you murder Zahra?
No, ma'am.
Why do you deny this when the evidence is overwhelmingly that you did?
Because I'll continue to stand by my story.
You'll continue to lie?
No, I'll stand by my story. Nobody was listening to what I was saying. They were going by circumstantial evidence. They weren't going by anything I was saying.
You are as guilty as sin. You are a guilty woman. And you will not take responsibility for your actions.
Welcome to True Crime Brewery. I'm Jill.
And I'm Dick.
In her 10 years, Zahra Baker had gone through a lot and overcome more than most adults. She was a cancer survivor who had to have an amputation, the removal of part of her lung, and she was left hearing impaired from cancer treatments. But she was still beautiful, inside and out. A resilient spirit with a child's pure love of the simple things in life, Zahra was a person worthy of much more than she got. Zahra deserved better from this world. Of all the cases we've covered on True Crime Brewery, unfortunately, many of them involving the murders of children. This may very well be the most upsetting. Researching this case really brought home to me how much our children depend on us. children are at the mercy of the adults who are designated as their caretakers. Usually, these are adults who love them and do everything in their power to keep them safe. But for Zahra, she truly had no one looking out for her. Zahra lived with an abusive stepmother, her father, too slow or too distracted to provide the protection she needed. Elisa Baker eventually killed 10-year-old Zahra, and for nearly 2 weeks, no one even seemed to notice. Elisa had a history of being abusive, and there were signs that Zahra was her victim. Zahra's death at her hands was an atrocity and a tragedy. In today's show, Step Monster, we're telling Zahra's story.
So you might want a beer.
I might want more than one beer.
Yeah, you could. So North Carolina crime, North Carolina beer. I'm going to do a beer called Freak of Nature, double IPA from Wicked Weed Brewing Company in Asheville. Now, Asheville is in western North Carolina, and it's kind of a renaissance city. There's a lot of beer happenings going on there, and Wicked Weed is at the forefront. They're a very, very good brewery. So this double IPA is a mostly clear orange color, has a thin ivory-colored head, and maybe a touch of lacing, not much. There's a pine and tropical fruit aroma, and a very strong pine taste, a little mango, and some white bread, or maybe the crust of the white bread, you know, just a hint. It's a medium-bodied, very easy drinking beer. Nice one. Try that. Try other Wicked Weed beers.
All right, let's open it up and head down to the quiet end.
Let's go.
What's going on at the quiet end here today?
Well, you know what I noticed? It's open mic night.
Yes, yep.
So anybody can show up and do whatever they want, right? That's the object of an open mic?
I think so, but I think there might be a signing up process.
Yeah, but it doesn't have to be all singing.
I mean, No.
Because I remember when we went to, the guy did some stand-up that was really great.
Yeah.
He used to be a patient of mine.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but he's all grown up. He's like 30 years old, so he's graduated from me.
Yeah.
But he's quite funny.
Huh.
And I really enjoyed that.
You gotta love an open mic night.
And then there's that singer. What's her name? I forget her name, but she was excellent. Local girl. She's appeared on some rap videos with a friend of our son's.
Jacobson. Yes. Our local rapper Jacobson.
Yeah. But she was on there, and she did a great show.
Yes, she has a beautiful voice.
So I'm looking forward to that. I hope we can stick around afterwards and maybe listen. I'm not going to do any open mic stuff.
No?
No, I think not.
I think we spent enough time behind the mic, so let's get started on our story.
Okay. So Zahra Baker came from a tiny Australian town where her father, Adam, worked at a sugar mill. Now, after she was born, Zahra's mother gave custody over to Adam because she suffered from severe postpartum depression and could not care for Zahra properly. So while Adam worked, his mother, Karen, took care of Zahra. In 2005, when she was 4 or 5 years old, she was diagnosed with cancer, and she had a bone cancer that had metastasized to her lungs. So she had probably either an osteosarcoma or a Ewing sarcoma. Those are the two most common bone cancers in kids.
And what is the prognosis with those cancers?
Not real great.
No, really?
I mean, they're okay, but if they metastasize like hers did, that makes it a lot more difficult.
So there's a good chance it would have returned again?
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, okay. Wow.
Now, Zahra is a pretty tough kid. She seemed to take all this in stride. So Zahra had cancer therapy, and it was in remission, but it returned in 2007. And this time her left leg had to be amputated above the knee. Now, Zahra seemed to take this all in stride, and she told friends she was getting a Barbie leg. Wow.
Yeah, well, that's one way to describe it, right?
It's true.
And, you know, kids do take these things in stride. They're the most flexible about life.
Yeah, so she had the amputation. Then a few months later, the tumors were found in her lungs, and she had surgery and chemo again. So the treatment stopped the cancer, at least for a time. But the chemotherapy seriously impaired her hearing to the point where she needed hearing aids.
And that would be permanent hearing loss?
That's permanent hearing loss. So she was out of school for a year, but friends and family pitched in to get her a laptop, and she kept up with her studies. She sounds like a cool little kid.
Yeah.
So she was featured in a local news story about a trip she took to Camp Quality, which is an Australian charity for children with cancer. She did the ropes course, and her prosthetic leg never held her back. "They don't make them much better than little Zahra Baker," wrote reporter Jessica Johnson. "This 8-year-old girl has overcome more challenges than most people would in a lifetime. Nothing could wipe the smile off the bubbly youngster's face yesterday."
Adam met Elisa on a social network site called IMVU, and in this site, users create 3D avatars of themselves and interact with each other. They soon called themselves soulmates, and their long-distance virtual relationship continued for 2 years.
Don't you think? Here's the curmudgeon in me again.
Okay.
It always amazes me that people that are online friends become soulmates. Now, how the hell can you become a soulmate if you've never seen this person or interacted with them other than on the internet? And you have no way of knowing what's true and what's not true.
I know, but I hate to just knock everybody's relationship that has a relationship this way. Who am I to judge?
Well, I'm not judging. I'm just saying, how can you have a relationship?
I don't know, but people do.
Well, but somehow.
Sort of. This is extremely weird, though, with the avatars. I mean, I'm just thinking my mind's going to a bad place where the avatars have sex and stuff like that, right?
Well, they might.
I'm assuming. Kind of like The Sims. So it's kind of creepy to me.
Well, creepy, yes, and just not fulfilling.
Well, you can't say that because you've never done it. But I can see how it's hard to imagine it would be.
It is.
Yes.
To me.
Well, I mean, I can say that you don't really know until you're actually with a person. I would agree.
Thank you.
Okay. So I guess along those lines, Adam bought a plane ticket for Elisa to visit him in 2008.
Well, good. So we've progressed to a point where he wants to meet her.
So she came over to Australia.
Now, it's been 2 years that they've been doing this.
Yeah.
But he finally coughed up something.
Well, it's not cheap to fly to Australia.
No, it isn't.
No. So she goes to Australia and meets him. Family and friends are not impressed with Elisa from the beginning. For one thing, she's constantly lying. I mean, everybody who knew her would say that. Even people who like her say, yes, she lied all the time. She told them she'd been a cop who had been shot in the line of duty. She also said she'd been a bounty hunter, and she knew Dog the Bounty Hunter. You know, the bleached blonde guy on TV?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I think maybe if she didn't tell such fantastic lies, maybe she would have been more believable.
Yeah, but these people who lie like that, they like to
do
the fantastic ones.
It's easy to prove or disprove that she'd been shot if there's no bullet holes in her.
Yeah.
Or a scar.
Right. Who knows, though? She might have had a scar that she said was a bullet.
Well, okay. It's tough.
Yeah.
Anyway, Adam and Elisa got married in July of 2008.
Yeah.
So
Pretty quick.
It was love.
It was.
True love.
5 months later, they moved to Elisa's home in North Carolina in the U.S. And Zahra, of course, she lost her friends, her family, and the whole supportive community that she'd been growing up in. Her grandmother, who was her primary caretaker, was heartbroken by this.
I can imagine. Because Adam is either
kind of useless,
too dumb or too uninvolved to do anything for her.
Mm-hmm.
Grandma's taking care of this kid. She's seen her through her bouts of cancer, treatment of cancer. She must really love that kid.
Well, and I'm sure she's invested in her future, which would probably be more
dealing with that. They're going to pick up and move to the United States.
And we'll find that once she was in the United States, she didn't get the medical care she should have had either. She wasn't being followed up.
She didn't get any care.
No, it's true. When Adam, Elisa, and Zahra came to the United States in 2008, they needed a place to live, of course. Adam and Elisa didn't have jobs, hadn't planned for that, and they were hoping that somebody would just help them out of the kindness of their heart. And someone did. It was Elisa's father, Marshall Fairchild. He lived in Hickory, North Carolina, and he said the family could live with him temporarily as they got settled in. Zahra adjusted quite well to living in North Carolina. She would talk about Australia, missing her grandma, and her large backyard where she could catch frogs and play with friends. But life at home in the U.S. was very strict for Zahra. If she didn't eat everything on her plate, she was sent to bed for the whole night. When it snowed and she was excited to play outdoors, Adam didn't want her to. But Marshall Fairchild tried to make some changes, and he did convince Adam to let Zahra go out and play a little bit.
Yes, and then there's a friend of the Fairchilds, Geraldine Rich. She had known Elisa since she was a kid, and she worried for Zahra's mental health, growing up with Elisa, who she viewed as a habitual liar, and maybe worse. Now, sometimes when Adam and Elisa wanted some time alone, they allowed Zahra to stay with the Rich family for a weekend. And the Riches would take Zahra to Saturday night dances where older couples brought their grandchildren and the kids played with each other while the old folks danced.
Yeah, and this was fun for her. Geraldine said that Zahra loved to dance too, and you'd never know that she had a prosthetic leg. She was cheerful, smiling, and just having fun.
She was. It sounded like as long as she was out from under the auspices of her stepmother, she did well.
Yes.
Now, Adam and Elisa had problems after the move. They had major financial trouble. Well, yeah, they had no jobs.
No savings.
And they kept borrowing money. So they were able to hide their problems for a while from Elisa's father. Now, they told him they were paying household bills, and that was in exchange for them living there. They also said they were going to buy a 1988 Camaro from Fairchild. But they never paid him, and Elisa broke the steering column in an accident. Now, Fairchild, Elisa's father, eventually became fed up with the couple, and he told them to move out, and even took out a complaint against Elisa. Now, once they did move out, he realized that they hadn't paid any of the bills as they said they would, and he had hundreds of dollars in unpaid electric and cable bills.
And he wasn't a wealthy man, so this was a hardship for him.
Yeah, none of the people involved are wealthy.
No.
Or even middle class.
No, I think it's a working class, you know, week-to-week living. It's not an easy life.
It isn't.
The Bakers rented a trailer in a trailer park after that. Their neighbor, Tanya Hefner, was raising four children in her spotless little trailer in that park. Now, she had a rough time. She had a tough exterior, but she was doing the best she could. And when she realized what was going on with Zahra, she acted. The Baker's trailer was up a steep, narrow road in the park. Hefner and her neighbors saw that Zahra walked with a limp, and they didn't immediately know that she had a prosthetic leg. But Elisa was frequently marching her up and down a steep hill while hitting and cursing her. Hefner said, "The whole neighborhood had seen her hit Zahra. We heard Elisa cuss her up and down the hill and make fun of her about her leg. She would say, 'Oh, you think you're so good? I think you should get that limp out of your leg. You need to get up that hill.' And she would smack her and tell her, 'Walk faster.' And it was just an awful thing to see." So eventually, Hefner says that she made a sworn statement to police that Elisa had threatened her after she, enraged by Zahra's treatment, had confronted Elisa. Hefner said she also told authorities that Zahra was being abused and contacted the local school that Zahra was attending at the time to let them know. The school, she says, told her they had concerns also that Zahra was being abused and that she had very poor attendance at school. So it's not going unnoticed.
No, it isn't. I think people are trying to help her. So the couple teachers from Zahra's school visited her home after she turned up at her fourth grade class at Hudson Elementary School with a black eye. And according to some in the trailer park, one teacher even gave Zahra her mobile phone number because she was concerned for her. Now, the school has not spoken publicly about what was known or done. Something did trigger a response because the Bakers did move again. This time they set up a house in an apartment in Granite Falls, North Carolina, and Zahra attended Granite Falls Elementary. Her school picture was posted online, and somehow Zara's birth mother, who had been looking for her, saw the picture from her laptop in Australia. So she must have known that they were in the United States in North Carolina.
I think so, yes, she'd been looking for her intermittently.
How else are you going to find an elementary school picture?
Right, exactly. Yeah, she was looking for her, and then she saw the picture, so maybe she was getting closer.
Right. And it's not clear if the notice of this picture prompted the Bakers to move, or if the apartment manager asked them to leave because they had been known for loud public arguments. So they moved again, this time in the start of the school year of 2010, which is about 6 weeks before Zahra was reported missing. They moved into a small house in Hickory. So this is four moves, at least, in a year and a half or so. So the couple told friends and family that Zahra was homeschooled.
Yeah, so let's talk a little bit about homeschooling, because I know there are many genuine parents who homeschool, but we often hear about people taking advantage of that.
We have.
To hide abuse.
And we've talked about it before, actually, in another North Carolina case.
Absolutely. So Caldwell County School's policy is to make contact with families when children don't show up for school within the first 10 days. Granite Hills Elementary said that their jurisdiction ended when Zahra was moved to a new district, when they moved to that house. And then her mother reported that she would be homeschooling Zahra. So there are records of follow-up calls, but no response from the Bakers. The North Carolina law says public school officials must be notified if a child is to be homeschooled. All homeschools must be registered, too. But there's absolutely no evidence that Zahra received any education as required. Neither Adam nor Elisa applied for homeschool certification. So, for some reason, somehow, she was kept out of school and no application was even made for homeschooling. And it's pretty clear that there was no homeschooling going on.
No. And I think some of it is that they switched school districts, so you kind of get lost in the shuffle a little bit. The former district can say, well, they moved, and basically it's not our problem anymore.
Yes, and I think that probably Elisa knew that. That was part of the reason for the move, possibly.
Possibly. And then the new school district, I think they had to be notified of the Bakers' intent
to homeschool,
which they never were. So they have no idea that there's a new student in their district, right?
Well, I think she told them she was going to homeschool. But then nobody followed up with her applying for a homeschool registration or doing anything about it. Adam Baker called and reported his daughter Zahra missing on October 9, 2010, saying that he suspected she'd been kidnapped. It started out as a missing person case, but right away, the police suspected that Zahra had been killed. After arriving at the Baker home, officials collected information to issue an Amber Alert. Adam and his wife Elisa gave them permission to search their house. The Bakers were living in a small brick house behind a tire store in Northern Hickory. Adam and Elisa shared a bedroom, and Zahra slept in the other bedroom. They shared one bathroom. Zahra lived in poverty in this house, owning very few possessions. Investigator David Rocket was called to the house around noontime. The house was poorly lit and dirty. There were two large fish tanks in the living room. One was cloudy and had no fish. The other had tree frogs living in it. There were photos of Adam and Elisa on the walls, but none of Zahra or of Elisa's two older daughters.
Yeah, and Zahra's room in particular was a depressing sight. The room was very sparse, and it went beyond anything that could be explained by lack of funds. It had been painted in a splotchy pink pattern that looked really careless and sloppy, like people are just slapping paint on the wall. Zahra had a few pieces of clothing in her closet and a strawberry shortcake poster inside the closet door. She had an old tackle box with art supplies, because Zahra liked to draw, and a few of her own drawings were tacked to the walls. There was no bureau, but there was a plastic cabinet where she kept a few toys, and most of the toys were Monster High dolls. So these were toys that were a combination of monsters like Frankenstein and the Wolfman in fashionable clothes like Barbies. These were her favorites.
Yes, she was a little character.
So in her little desk, officers came across a letter that was addressed to a boy, and she had some open letters from the same boy. So, a little boyfriend.
A little boyfriend.
Now, Zahra's room, despite its disarray, was the brightest room in the house. The master bedroom was painted a dark purple-black color, and it was filled with a large waterbed, so there was barely room to maneuver around in.
Investigators talked to Adam and Elisa in the living room. Adam seemed pretty relaxed, maybe too relaxed. Elisa seemed upset. She called Zahra her angel and said she never let her out of her sight. She kept telling the officers what a great mother she was. When Adam tried to talk, she frequently interrupted him. Patrol officer Melissa Christie found an October 2010 Duke Energy bill without a return envelope in the master bedroom. This raised a red flag for investigators because a ransom note had been found earlier that morning and it had been written on a Duke Energy bill.
Uh-huh. Envelope missing.
Yes.
So the ransom note was discovered on the windshield of a Chevy Tahoe that Adam drove for his job. The ransom note was discovered on the windshield of the Chevy Tahoe that Adam drove for his job. The note was found by officers who responded to a fire in the Baker's backyard that occurred about 5:30 in the morning. But it wasn't until 2 o'clock in the afternoon that Adam Baker called police to report Zahra missing. So the police are there pretty early in the morning for this fire, and he doesn't say anything because he doesn't know, I guess. That's his story.
About what? About Zahra.
That his daughter's missing.
Right, he doesn't know. He told police that someone had poured gasoline in his car during the night and left this ransom note, and that he believed his daughter was taken by whoever threatened his boss, Mr. Coffee, because...
Now, wait a minute. Why would you leave a ransom note on a car that you're torching?
We don't know. This is the story.
I mean, that's just a weird fucking story.
It totally is, but we're telling the story as he told it.
I know.
But yes, definitely there are some red flags, and yeah. I think the police noticed it as much as we do.
The police picked it up pretty quickly.
I would imagine.
So what did the note say?
The note said, Mr. Coffee, you like being in control, and who is in control now? We have your daughter, and your pot-smoking redhead son is next. Unless you do what is asked, $1 million unmarked will be in touch soon. So it's just like one long sentence, no punctuation. It also said, no cops, twice.
So clearly the author of the note is a literate person.
Is a literate person or an illiterate person?
I was being sarcastic.
Well, I mean, they could write. Maybe not the best, but...
Well, that's just a stupid note.
Yes, but that's the least of the problems here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So officers found handwriting samples that they wanted to compare to the note. And the Baker house was on a lot that was a little bit less than an acre. And the backyard was a tangled mess of overgrown bushes and trees, old tires and mulch. Because Adam worked for a tree service company.
Yes.
So there's all sorts of shit lying around.
Yes, stuff would be dumped off there that he would need to haul away.
Yep.
So it wasn't just that they had a messy yard, it was part of his job. Neighbors said that Zahra was seldom outdoors playing anyway. Officers climbed under the house into the crawl space and looked for places where a 10-year-old child might hide. They searched the yard, but they only found trash and piles of brush. 30 minutes after the police first arrived at the house, the police department's victim services coordinator, Elia Burwell, was called in. She was told about the ransom note and introduced to Elisa and Adam. Elisa rocked back and forth on the sofa. After 15 minutes or so of talking, Adam went outdoors. Elisa's oldest daughter, Amber, came to the house, and police kept her outside to talk to her.
Yeah, now Elisa had called Amber already twice that day. The first time that she called was early in the morning to tell Amber that there had been a fire in their backyard. Now, Amber was still asleep when that call came in, and it was a pretty short call. Elisa called Amber a second time, a couple hours later, to tell Amber that Zahra had gone missing.
So, Amber was alarmed and came to the house.
Where she wasn't allowed in.
By police, because police are searching and they're talking to Elisa inside.
Right.
So Elisa is sitting on the sofa, and she tells Aaliyah Burwell that the kidnappers had taken the wrong child, and Mark Coffey needed to go on TV, pay this ransom, and get Zahra back for them. She talked on and on about Zahra. She said that they had bonded quickly after she married Zahra's father, Adam. She and her Australian stepdaughter, Zahra, had both survived cancer, she said. Zahra had lost her hearing and her left leg, and Elisa said that she had her own health problems, including fibromyalgia and brain cancer. Elisa said that she had frequent seizures and she had undergone gastric bypass surgery. So now she's turning the focus to herself, which I find bizarre and makes her very unlikable. She said she was lucky to be alive.
Right. Now, the only difference between Zahra's illness and Elisa's was that Zahra's cancer was real, and Elisa's were a figment of her imagination. Elisa said that Zahra had been her nurse because she was sick all the time.
That makes me angry.
So we're still presenting it as about me, not about the missing child.
Well, and she's saying right up front that she had a 10-year-old child taking care of her.
Yep.
Pretty sick. So Elisa did not present well.
That's an understatement.
She also looked weird. She'd recently dyed her hair black, and she had hair color stains on the skin all around her face. So these smudges were very distracting. She was upset, and her eyes were wet, but she didn't seem that genuine. Adam did seem to have some genuine concern. Mark Coffey, Adam's boss, showed up within an hour, and he was still in his tennis clothes from the country club. He said he was worried about Zahra and wanted to know if he could do anything to help. So he was interviewed by an investigator in a police car outside.
Yeah, and during this interview, Coffey revealed the first in a long line of lies from the Bakers. He didn't think that Zahra was at the Oktoberfest party with her father and stepmother on October 8th, as they had told police. Coffey said he had stopped by that evening and saw Adam and Elisa back in their car out of the driveway on their way to Oktoberfest, and Zahra wasn't in the car.
So that was just the night before.
That's the night before this fire and the notification of the disappearance.
Mm-hmm.
So police decided to take Adam and Elisa to the station to be questioned further. As Elisa sat in the cruiser, she watched officers surrounding her home with crime scene tape in order to secure the house for an investigation. So in an unemotional tone, she asked Burwell, why are they putting up the crime scene tape? Do they think Zahra was murdered in there? Now, what kind of statement's that?
That was very shocking to Burwell, but she tried not to show it to Elisa. No, she said, they're just putting up the tape because evidence technicians are coming and they want to preserve any evidence so they can find Zahra. Adam was driven separately to the station. In interviews, Adam seemed honest. He was heartbroken, but then his lack of oversight in his daughter's life was really quite stunning.
I'm just amazed.
Yeah.
I mean, how do you claim you haven't seen your kid for 2 weeks and not be worried?
When you live in the same house.
Right.
Yeah.
I mean, Jesus.
He talked about Zahra's personality and about what a fighter she was to overcome all of her hardships. He didn't seem to know what had happened to Zahra, but he's clearly negligent here and even willfully ignorant, I would say.
Yeah, definitely. So police are starting to get a picture of Adam, who might be a terrible father, but probably was not a murderer. However, Elisa was a totally different story.
Yes, now they're really looking at her.
Yeah, I think they're looking at Adam and say, well, he's dumber than a bag of something.
It's not. Soot? You said S.
Yeah, I don't know. What do I want to say? They're looking at Adam and thinking that he's dumb as shit, but probably not involved in her disappearance.
Sure, but it goes beyond dumb. I feel like he had some idea something was wrong and he was purposely ignoring it because he didn't want to believe it.
Yeah, well, I think we'll find that out when they do his lie detector test.
Right, that's true. Well, many aspects of Zahra's case led the investigators right away to believe there was foul play. The ransom note was clearly suspicious, and there were many more things that really made no sense. Why would a kidnapper take Zahra's prosthesis? Because wouldn't that make it easier for her to escape?
Right. And if you're kidnapping, why do you take that anyway? You just snatch the child and get the hell out of there.
You would think. And also, like you said, why put a ransom note near a fire?
Yeah, who's going to read the ransom note when it's all burned up?
Yeah, I don't know. And why did the Bakers lie about taking Zahra to Oktoberfest? So that's very suspicious if you're lying to police. And when was the last time, they wanted to know, when anyone besides Elisa and Adam had seen Zahra? They really couldn't find anyone who'd seen her recently.
No, they hadn't. So they issued an Amber Alert. Now, the Amber Alert system is named for Amber Hagerman, a child who was kidnapped and killed in Texas in 1996. The system was developed in Dallas and spread across the country. The state of North Carolina created its Amber Alert program in 2002. Now, for an Amber Alert to be issued, 4 criteria must be met. A child must be 17 or younger, believed to be abducted, not taken by a parent unless they are in danger, and not believed to be a runaway. So in 2009 in North Carolina, 53 requests were made and 18 alerts were issued. In 2010, 47 requests were made and 10 were issued, Zahra's being one of them.
Yeah, so they don't want to just willy-nilly issue an alert because they want it to be taken seriously.
Right. Well, as I said, there's criteria that have to be met.
Yes. So it really looks like there's only like 20% or so that actually become an Amber Alert.
Right. There's not a huge percentage of requests that turn into alerts.
Right, exactly. When the alert was issued on Zahra, information about her was given to radio and TV stations, newspapers, local and state law enforcement, the Department of Transportation, and the North Carolina Center for Missing Persons. Information was then displayed on electronic highway signs and on lottery terminals.
I like that.
Yeah.
Everybody's checking out the lottery terminals. What better place to notify Amber Alert?
That's true. I mean, we never play the lottery, so that hadn't occurred to me, but I could see that that's probably a good thing to do.
I think they get a lot of people that are looking at those things.
Yeah. So these electronic highway signs, we've seen that, especially in Florida, on missing old people, silver alerts.
Silver alerts.
And we've
seen a couple Amber Alerts, too.
Yes.
It seems like every time we go there, there's some kind of alert.
Yes. In December 2012, the Federal Emergency Management Agency, FEMA, started to implement the Wireless Emergency Alert Program. And that's the one that sends out the text alerts to cell phones. And you actually have a setting on your phone that you can turn on or off to receive these.
Right.
But this wasn't available when Zahra was missing, so this didn't come into play at the time.
Now, it turns out that both Elisa and Adam had warrants for their arrests on the same day that Adam called 911 to report Zahra missing. Now, most of these warrants were for bad checks, but others were for obtaining property by false pretenses and other things for what would be considered petty crimes, but crimes nonetheless.
Now, these crimes painted a picture of these two people who are very short-sighted and always short on cash. Elisa's nephew, Zachary Bard, and his fiancée, Brittany Bentley, had filed charges against the pair for threatening them with weapons after going after them for money owed from a business these two couples had started together where they sold knockoff handbags. Baird said that the Bakers had a .45 pistol and a stun gun when they threatened him and his 8-year-old child. Elisa had said something to the effect of how she knew where their baby lived. So that's really awful.
Yes, it is.
Adam blatantly threatened to shoot Zachary Bard, they said, but Adam denies that. A court had dismissed the charges of threatening by Adam, but they found him guilty of assault with a deadly weapon for trying to run the couple off the road with his car. So he's no angel.
No, Adam's not.
You can't write this off to him not being bright. He's actually does some bad things.
Sure.
He was sentenced to 30 days in county jail, but his sentence was suspended and it was pending an appeal at the time all this happened.
Yeah, so when Adam's 911 call was made public, many people thought he sounded way too calm. Now, we've discussed this before about how you're supposed to act, but investigators said it was only his personality. The call lasted 4 minutes, and in the call, Adam says, yeah, my daughter is missing. So he gave his address and mentioned the fire in the ransom note. He said it appeared that the kidnappers accidentally took his daughter instead of his boss's daughter. He said, we checked in last night around 2:30, and she was there, and all this happened around 5, so suggesting the kidnappers may have set a fire in his car to distract them. He also told the dispatcher about Zahra's disabilities.
So here we have another case of a child falling through the cracks. Let's just take a deep breath and tell our listeners about today's sponsors.
Okay. How's that? Did I take a good breath?
That was good.
Away is a company that offers high-quality luggage that is designed to be resilient, resourceful, and essential to the way you travel. Away is available in a variety of colors and 4 sizes, including carry-on sizes that are compliant with all major U.S. airlines. The Away suitcase is lightweight, strong, and impact-resistant. Away is a game-changer.
It really is.
I get on the plane with it. It's easy to lift into the overhead compartments, and it looks great. And each bag features a TSA-approved combination lock, 4 360-degree spinner wheels, and a patent-pending compression system to help overpackers like my lovely wife.
Well, here's the best part for me. Both sizes of the carry-on are able to charge anything that's powered by a USB cord. That means your phone, iPad, Kindle, laptop, everything, basically. So no more huddling with the masses at airport charging stations, and a single charge of your suitcase will power your iPhone 5 times. So it's a good amount of charging there. Remember George Clooney in Up in the Air? Wonderful movie.
What a great movie.
Clooney's character was constantly traveling for business, and there's a scene where he's showing Anna Kendrick how to travel smart and be efficient. The away carry-ons would definitely get Clooney's approval. Light, strong, built-in charger, combo lock, wheels that turn every which way. Plus, they're very reasonably priced, long-lasting, and they are great-looking.
Yeah, we use our away carry-ons everywhere we travel. It's so nice not to worry about having a dead phone.
Well, and it came with the different plug adapters for different countries as well.
So try out Away for 100 days. Vibe with it, travel with it, Instagram it. If at any point you decide it's not for you, return it for a full refund. Shipping is free within the lower 48 states. And thanks to Away's lifetime warranty, if anything breaks, they'll fix it. So you've got nothing to lose.
Nothing to lose. For $20 off a suitcase, visit awaytravel.com/brewery. Use promo code brewery during checkout. That's awaytravel.com/brewery and promo code brewery for $20 off your Away suitcase. Now, if you're a fan of True Crime Brewery, you probably love true crime. That's easy to say. So let me tell you about a new podcast I love. Dick, when you think of a criminal, what do you picture?
Well, my stereotype is a big guy in dark clothes, maybe in a van. He could be kind of a golden boy like Scott Peterson, or a total weirdo like John Wayne Gacy.
But you don't immediately think of a woman, do you?
No.
Sexist. No, just kidding. But really, that's why I'm loving this new podcast called Female Criminals. Every week, the hosts of Female Criminals take a psychological approach to analyzing the stories and the motivations of the women who have done the worst, most heinous crimes ever. Each episode looks into the minds and motivations of these women. The hosts dive deep into the lives of infamous female criminals, giving me each woman's backstory, and you know how I love a good backstory.
I do.
Episodes on the cocaine goddess are available now. It's been estimated that she was responsible for up to 200 murders while transporting cocaine from Colombia to New York, Miami, and Southern California. Yeah, not a nice woman.
That's mind-boggling. Upwards of 200 killings?
Yes.
Holy shit.
With a new episode of Female Criminals coming out every Wednesday, it's not going to interfere with your TCB habits. They have episodes coming up on Aileen Wuornos, Mata Hari, and lots more. Visit Apple Podcasts, TuneIn, Spotify, Google Play, or wherever you listen to TCB, and search for Female Criminals. Again, that's FemaleCriminals. Or just visit parcast.com/criminals to start listening now. That's PARCAST, parcast.com/criminals to listen to that now.
So back to the story. The emergency personnel had arrived at the Baker home early that morning when Elisa had called 911 about a fire in their backyard. Now, Elisa said she woke up to go to the bathroom and saw something flickering outside the window. So she woke up Adam, who went to check on it, and he tried to put out the fire with a bucket of water. Now, Adam told the investigators that a car door woke him up. So that's a little bit of a contrast already.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Elisa says she woke him up. Adam says a car door woke him up. He said he looked out the front of his house and saw nothing. He looked out the back and he saw the fire.
Now, Elisa was waiting at the end of the driveway for the fire department when they came. Firefighters went to the backyard of the Baker home, and they found a 3-foot by 3-foot pile of burning mulch. So, big deal. The firefighters were worried that this was going to be a much larger fire because Elisa had said her husband worked for a landscaping business, and they thought there would be large piles of wood and brush burning in the yard. But this was really hardly a fire, just a few branches burning. Which makes me think she was just trying to get attention to the house and to this note, of course.
And the suspicion or the thought is that they set the fire.
Well, that Elisa did, right?
Or Elisa did.
Mm-hmm.
And set it so that it wouldn't be a threat to the house or become a major conflagration. but just enough of a fire to want to call the cops.
Yeah. Firefighters did call the Hickory Police Department because they always do when the cause of a fire is unknown. Adam approached the officer with the note that he found on the windshield of the Chevy Tahoe, saying that Mark Coffey's daughter had been taken. Firefighters had found the passenger side doors of the Tahoe both open, and the car reeked of gasoline. The officer had just read the note saying that Mr. Coffey's daughter was taken for the $1 million ransom when Mr. Coffey showed up. He had a teenage girl with him. The officer asked Coffey if the teen was his daughter, and he said yes. He said, "Your only daughter?" "Well, yes."
Oops.
Yeah.
I guess she hadn't been kidnapped.
I guess not.
So once it was confirmed that it was not his daughter that was kidnapped, Coffey speculated to the officer that maybe a former disgruntled employee may have been behind it. So the police are looking at the Tahoe. Gasoline had been poured on it, but there were no matches or anything around that would have been used to set the fire. So Elisa never came outside to speak to the officer, and Adam never mentioned his daughter Zahra.
Now I would think you'd go check on your daughter if there's a fire and there's a ransom note.
One would suspect that.
But the bakery yard, it lined up to the back of a restaurant called Bistro 127. Coffey owned the house and the restaurant building. There were security cameras behind Bistro 127, but there was no clear footage of who had set that fire. The police were uncertain of the purpose of the fire, but they would later guess that it had been used to alert officials that Zahra was gone. At some point, Elisa would need to tell a story about Zara's disappearance, and this would help her do that.
Yeah, because eventually people are going to figure out that Zara's not around.
But doesn't it break your heart that no one's figured it out yet?
Doesn't it?
It breaks my heart.
It's been 2 weeks, right?
Yeah, and a little girl is gone.
Yeah, and the neighbors said they didn't even know they had a daughter.
Right.
Wow.
But the officer that morning, of course, he didn't look for Zahra because he didn't know she existed. And
no,
the ransom note,
because they weren't saying anything.
No, and the ransom note threatened Coffey's daughter. Didn't say anything about Baker's having a daughter.
Yeah. Adam says he believes Zahra was inside sleeping, so he didn't ask her to come outside. And because she had impaired hearing, he didn't question why she didn't hear all of that was happening in the backyard. And he also said that she was going through a broody stage, and she only came out of her room when she was hungry or wanted something. I don't know, 10 years old?
Well, they could. Sometimes girls start early with that, but still.
That's always more of a teenage thing, right?
Yeah. But, I mean, still, you're going to go in and check on her. You're going to talk to her. Any normal parent would have some kind of contact with their child regardless.
Absolutely. I mean, here, you wake up, there's a fire in your backyard. Your first inclination is to make sure your family's safe.
Absolutely.
Right?
Well, and just every normal day you get up for work. You don't see your kid, you're going to peek in. You don't see them the night before at dinner because they're in their room. Well, you're going to go say goodnight to them, or you're going to check on them in the morning, something.
Not Adam.
No.
So Zahra had been dead for 2 weeks when Adam finally called on October 9th.
Yeah.
So why did the call come in that day? There's one theory that's related to an inspector who came to the house on October 8th. This man asked for Mr. Coffey, and Elisa sent him away. So there's evidence that points to Elisa being concerned that the inspector is coming to check on Zara's homeschooling, which they were supposed to be doing anyway.
Yeah, maybe she thought the authorities were catching up to her, so she set the fire to create the story of Zara's kidnapping on that day.
That's pretty plausible.
I think so. I mean, they were short-sighted, so it's not like she was planning for 2 weeks what she would do.
No.
No.
So on October 9th, Adam was in the company truck picking up trees and stumps that had been left here and there and putting them into his truck. Truck motor was very loud, so at first he didn't hear Elisa when she ran out yelling something to him. Turned off the truck and heard her saying, "Zahra's gone," over and over.
Now, so this is how he learned it.
Yeah, now give me a break.
What do you want a break for this time?
I mean, geez, this kid hasn't been seen for 2 weeks.
Yes.
And his wife comes out saying, "Oh, Zahra's gone." So does he think she's been there the whole time?
That's what he says, and that's what
his wife is taking care of her?
It seems to be what he believed.
It just stretches my incredibility.
I know, but that seems to be what he believed, that he was trusting her completely.
Okay.
But police began their massive search that day, of course, which spanned thousands of miles. But before that, Adam drove around the block looking for his daughter. But Zahra had never wandered off before. Adam drove to the Lake Hickory Country Club to talk to Mark Coffey, and he told Coffey that maybe the kidnappers took Zahra by mistake. So I really think that Elisa had planted that idea in his head.
Yeah, I don't think he's smart enough to do that himself.
No. So it was Mark Coffey who told Adam, well, you need to go home and call the police right away. What the fuck are you doing, basically?
No kidding. So this missing child case was different from the very beginning. Parents called in missing children often because they leave home without telling them, they wander off, or there might be a custody dispute. But Zahra was disabled, and she had left her hearing aids behind, but she took her prosthesis. And then there was that weird fire and ransom note in the morning, so police are pretty concerned about foul play in Zahra's case.
Yeah, so Adam and Elisa are driven separately to the police station, and they're not allowed to be alone together once they're there. They were told that detectives would be working to eliminate them as suspects so they could begin to focus on who had really taken Zahra. During these interviews, Elisa's emotions fluctuated between nonstop talking and appearing to force herself to cry. She didn't seem genuine. She told them that she was pregnant with twins, but her eldest daughter told police that Elisa had a hysterectomy years earlier. So,
tough to be pregnant with twins then, huh?
Yes. So this whole lying without any thought to the fact that you're going to be caught baffles me.
Yeah, it does. Now, Elisa never became belligerent or uncooperative. She smiled and chuckled about what a sweet, cute kid Zahra was. But when police asked how many times she had been married, she became very vague.
Well, with good reason.
Well, yeah. Some bombshells.
Yeah.
To us and to her husband.
Yes. Eventually, she admitted that Aaron Young, a man she had told Adam was her brother, was actually her husband. She and Aaron were still married, too.
So she's a bigamist.
Yes. Investigators shared that information with Adam in a separate room, and he was quite stunned. He tried to say that they were wrong or that they must have misunderstood her. But they did convince him it was true, and he finally accepted that. Prior to this, Adam was under the false belief that Elisa had only been married twice. When he learned she was married at least five times before, and one of them was Aaron, her so-called brother, then he finally began to doubt everything Elisa had told him. Elisa's long history of deception was an excellent tool for investigators to drive a wedge between Adam and Elisa. Now Adam would finally stop protecting her. Throughout the night, Elisa continued to act her part as the worried mother, eager to help find her child. She even agreed to take a polygraph exam. So she took the polygraph, and she answered no to these three questions. Do you know the person who wrote the ransom note? No. Do you know if anyone has done harm to that child? No. Did you hurt Zahra? No. And the machine found deception in each of these answers.
To the naked eye, Elisa Baker's handwriting appeared to be a match with the writing on the ransom note.
When a detective confronted Elisa with the note and told her that they believed she had written it, that's when she stopped cooperating with them. Now, like Elisa, Adam had undergone intense interrogation. That evening was the first of over 20 interviews he would give. He was subjected to over 80 hours in total. Now, initially, police believed that Adam was responsible for Zahra's disappearance because men are usually the ones that commit violent crimes. Adam was calmer than most parents in this situation, but he did get teary-eyed a few times. He told police how Zahra had spent a lot of time in the hospital in her life, and she had beat two bouts of cancer. So he said she was a very optimistic and happy child. Adam said the last time he had seen Zahra was at the Oktoberfest in downtown Hickory on October 8th, the previous night, and they had returned home around 9 p.m. But the detective told Adam that there were surveillance cameras in downtown Hickory. He asked if they would see the three of them when they watched these tapes, and Adam stuck to his story, and he said, yes, you will.
Yeah, but we also have the testimony from his boss who said that it was just Adam and Elise in the car.
Yeah, but they're not telling him that yet.
No. But we know he's caught in a lie.
Yes, we do.
So Adam was also asked if he thought that Elisa had done something to Zahra, and he said he didn't think so. But he did agree to a polygraph because he said he wanted to exonerate himself and get his daughter back. So the three main questions that he was asked were, did you have anything to do with your daughter's disappearance? No. Do you have direct knowledge? Do you have direct involvement in hurting Zahra? No. Do you have any knowledge about who may have been involved in hurting your daughter? No.
It turned out that Adam did suspect someone. He thought it was Elisa. Because his questioning continued, Adam said again that he, Elisa, and Zahra had gone to Hickory's Oktoberfest on October 8th. He said that that was the last time he had seen her. Investigators were able to wear him down, and he admitted that Elisa had told him to lie. She had reminded him that he could get in trouble for being in the U.S., and Zahra could be taken away unless he lied, which makes no sense to me. Do you understand the thought process there?
No.
Okay.
But, you know, she says that to him, and he's stupid enough to believe her.
Seems like it, yeah.
I just think he's a piece of shit. Sorry.
Okay. But if he is unintelligent, that's not his fault. And we don't want to be saying he's a piece of shit because he's unintelligent. If you want to call him a piece of shit, call him a piece of shit because he was a bad father.
I'm going to call him a piece of shit because he's a bad father who wasn't interested in the welfare of his daughter.
I'm on board with that.
Okay.
Okay. So the truth was that Lisa told him Zahra didn't feel well on the 8th, so they decided to leave their sick child behind while they went out to have fun at the festival. So that sucks anyway.
Doesn't it? Sorry you're sick, but we're going out anyway. So Adam would be in frequent contact with the police after this first interview, and he took 3 polygraph exams and agreed to all requested interviews, whatever his fault as a parent, and they were numerous and huge.
Absolutely.
He did seem to genuinely want to find her.
Well, at that point he did.
He's feeling guilty at this point.
Okay.
That he's a shitty father.
I'm not going to defend him. That's not what I'm here for, so that's fine.
Okay.
Investigators used the polygraph to try and narrow down Zahra's location so they could improve their search. So there were 7 questions designed to find out where Adam believed Zahra was. So they think he kind of has a subconscious idea of what happened that he's repressing because he doesn't want to believe it. And I can go along with that.
I can too.
His reactions and answers led them to one probable location, Real Tree Services headquarters north of Morganton.
Now that's the company that he worked for. That's Coffee's company.
Yeah, yeah. Now he told police that his boss had been after him to burn a brush pile there. And Elisa knew about that. So Adam was afraid that she may have put Zahra there. Elisa's daughter Amber, that's her oldest daughter, told investigators that she didn't think Elisa or Adam had anything to do with Zahra disappearing. But she did mention her younger sister Brittany to them, and that's the first they even heard that she existed. Brittany was in Charlotte, and she agreed to meet police in Granite Falls. So she was interviewed in a patrol car there. Brittany said she hated her mom and hadn't had anything to do with her in several months. She last lived with Adam, Elisa, and Zahra in a trailer in early 2010. And she said she had terrible arguments with Elisa and hardly spent any time there. But Brittany said she loved Zahra, who was a happy, smiling child. She said Elisa would get angry with Zahra over absolutely nothing, and she would tell her she didn't walk correctly. She would make Zahra walk up a hill near their trailer until Zahra was crying in pain. Brittany said she took Zahra away with her one day after fighting with her mother. But after that, Elisa called Brittany and said she was going to call the police and report her for kidnapping. So Brittany brought her back. And after that, Brittany moved out for good. But then Elisa wouldn't let her see Zahra anymore. So the only way Brittany was able to see Zahra after that was if they both visited her big sister Amber at the same time. On one of these visits in May 2010, Zahra had a black eye. Brittany called the Caldwell County Department of Social Services about this. Brittany said that she knew her mother had hurt Zahra, but little Zahra wouldn't admit it, and that would be the last time she saw Zahra.
You know, these interviews with Elisa's daughters, Amber and Brittany, gave the police new insights to the situation. They now believe that it had been several days or even weeks since anyone outside of the home had seen Zahra. After her interview led into the morning of October 10th, Elisa requested an attorney. So detectives sent her and Adam home. Adam went to Brittany's apartment, while Elisa went to Amber's apartment, because their house is a crime scene. They can't go back there. So Elisa's looking guilty. Her comment about a possible murder in her house and the fact that her handwriting seemed to match the ransom note made her look bad. So while investigators had been interviewing family members, other officers ran background checks on the couple. And this is when they learned that both of them were wanted on outstanding warrants for bad checks and other petty crimes. But they held off arresting them, thinking it might be more beneficial to watch them and follow them.
Well, then they changed their minds, though, after Amber called, because she reported that Elisa was thinking about fleeing the state, possibly even the country. So Elisa was then arrested on several of her outstanding warrants.
Well, that would certainly get your attention if you're thinking that she's going to flee.
Yes. So it seems like Amber has some sympathy for her mother, but she's not going to put her mother above the law.
Right. And Brittany, her other daughter,
can't stand her, which seems like the right position to take.
Well, as it turns out.
Well, still no one had been charged in Zahra's disappearance, though. A special agent from the SBI was brought in to interview Elisa. And this time she was read her Miranda rights, but didn't ask for an attorney. The agent began the interview as if he knew nothing about Zahra or this case. And Elisa began to talk in circles. She wasn't really directly answering any of the questions. She repeatedly said that she was a good mother, and she would never do anything to hurt Zahra. In an effort to get Elisa to admit to writing the note, the agent decided he was just going to confront her directly. So he said, "We're past all that. We know you wrote the note. We just want to know why." And there was a very long pause, but she did give them an answer. She said, "I guess I wrote the note because Mark Coffey dictates everything Adam does and thinks that he's God, and I'm tired of it."
Yeah, she said that she wrote the note in the heat of the moment. And it didn't. That's a poor choice of words, right?
Yeah.
There's a fire going on?
Sure.
And it didn't have anything to do with Zahra. She had meant to take it off the Tahoe, but she didn't know anything about where Zahra was.
So that doesn't make sense.
Not at all.
No.
But Elisa didn't want to talk after that, so she mentioned an attorney, and she asked for Newton attorney David Moose.
So I guess he had a pretty good reputation.
Yeah. And once you do that, questioning's over, right?
Yes.
I want a lawyer.
Yep. So October 10th, the day after, police go door to door and talk to the Bakers' neighbors. Most of them had never seen Zahra and didn't even know a child lived in that home. And they were so upset to hear about Zahra that they made up flyers and walked through the neighborhoods asking if anyone had seen her.
Yeah, so that means that for some length of time, this poor little kid was basically a prisoner in the house.
Yes.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
She wasn't seen by anybody outside.
No.
What a horrible life.
I know. And then she's killed and no one even knows for 2 weeks.
Nope.
So the neighbors began leaving photos and letters at a large tree on the Baker's front lawn as kind of a remembrance about Zahra. After 43 days of things accumulating by the tree, Mark Coffey, who owned the property, cut the tree down and donated the toys to charity. Elisa was arrested on several outstanding warrants and eventually indicted on 9 felonies. She pled guilty to all 9. Between October 13th and September 15th, 2011, she appeared in courtrooms in Caldwell and Catawba counties and had more than a dozen court dates. So let's just talk a little bit about Elisa's background.
Okay. She'd been a very social person and active as a teen. As an adult, she kept a very neat house when her daughters were young. She always rented, but she painted her homes in bold colors. Now, despite this, she moved often. She wore pastels in her younger years, but in the few years before Zahra's disappearance, she began wearing black a lot and became attracted to Gothic images and fairies on her tops. She dyed her hair herself with mixed results, which are usually bad, and she got some tattoos of a dragon and dancing bears.
Elisa was first married when she was 17. She already had her daughter Amber. She married her second husband in 1985 when she was just 19. A few months after that wedding, she had a son named Douglas. About a year later, she had another child, that was Brittany, and the marriage ended in 1992. Amber and Brittany went to live with Elisa, but she left Douglas with his father. Now, over the next 16 years, Elisa married another 5 men, including Adam Baker. 3 ended up in a divorce or an annulment. Elisa and Aaron Young were legally divorced in 2009, but that was more than a year after she married Adam in July 2008.
Now, the Department of Social Services was involved with Elisa and her children and at least 5 counties that she had lived in. Elisa was well known for lying. She told family and friends more than once that she was suffering from a fatal disease. Many people put their own lives on hold to help her. They usually learned she was lying because her health did not get worse, and she obviously didn't die. When Brittany and Amber were young, Elisa told people that Brittany had a fatal disease, and she put Amber in a wheelchair. So now we're talking a little Munchausen by proxy stuff here, huh?
Well, she probably had some Munchausen with her own health,
she
right?
She did, yeah.
She's got a lot of things going on. I'd like to see a psychiatric report on her.
Couldn't find one.
Her family and old friends were unsure of what to think when Elisa pleaded guilty to second-degree murder in Zahra's death. She didn't seem like she would be capable of killing and dismembering a child, most of them thought. Although Brittany didn't seem to have any problem thinking that.
No, not at all.
Elisa's cousin, Kathy Winkler, was unsure what to think. She went on Nancy Grace to speak on behalf of Elisa's family, but later she felt like her comments were edited to make it look like she was defending Elisa, and that wasn't necessarily true. She visited Elisa in jail after she was arrested on obstruction of justice on October 12, 2010. Elisa told her she didn't kill Zahra. Still, Kathy wrote to Elisa and told her that no matter what happened, Zahra needed to be put to rest.
Yeah, so Kathy might have influenced Lisa in this regard because on October 24th, Elisa agreed to cooperate with law enforcement. She and her defense attorney led the police to 3 locations in Caldwell County. At 2 locations, they found Zahra's prosthesis and torso. No human remains were recovered at the 3rd location. She also told police where to find a mattress, a saw, and other evidence. So Elisa wrote to Kathy and said if she could just remember where Zahra's head is, then the truth would be known that she was not physically abused.
Jesus.
Holy cow. She told Kathy that she and Zahra were very close.
Yeah, I don't know who is believing that. I mean, she obviously tortured this child before she killed her.
Yes, she did.
For months or years. Amber and Brittany were helping police with the investigation. Amber said that her mother had been in contact with someone in London, online, up until a week before her arrest. Now, this man had given Elisa $10,000. They went out and interviewed this man, and he said that Elisa and he had met on this IMVU, the Avatar social networking site where she'd met Adam.
She's still working that site, huh?
Yeah. And she told this man that she had cancer and she was on medication that she couldn't afford. So he felt sorry for her. They talked a few times on the phone and he sent her $10,000 by Western Union. So this poor guy, obviously gullible, but he was trying to do a good thing, so I do feel bad.
Okay, you're more charitable than me.
But here's the problem. We don't know exactly how Zahra died, so that's a little bit of a problem as far as getting the conviction. We do know how Elisa said it happened. According to Elisa, it was a natural death, perhaps from choking on some ravioli, and Elisa panicked. She said that Zahra had been sick that day with a stomach bug, and when she went to check on her in her bedroom, she wasn't breathing. So she said, I didn't see her chest moving up and down. Automatically, I got scared and started doing CPR. And she said her biggest mistake was not calling 911. She said instead of calling 911, she called her husband Adam. She said that she remembers their conversation when he got home. She said she told Adam that they needed to call 911, but he said, sit down, take you some medicine, calm down, I'll take care of it. Then Elisa said she and Adam walked around the yard, and after several hours, he told her he wanted to go to Walmart to get out of the house, and they left deceased Zahra behind in her bedroom. So she says it wasn't until the next afternoon that Adam got utensils and trash bags from the kitchen, and then he went into the bathroom and turned on the water, drowning out the sound of what she says he was doing.
Now, I don't know about you, but I'm not quite believing this story.
Absolutely not. I don't think that he could do this to his own daughter, even though he was a real jerk. I don't see that happening.
No.
And anyway, if he was that type of guy, and she was a decent person, she wouldn't have gone along with this.
She wouldn't have?
No.
Elisa said Adam asked her to help get rid of Zahra's body, and she demanded answers.
Oh, sure she did.
Right. At this point, you needed to tell me what you did, because I'm scared, and I don't know what to do. And Adam said, you're going to take your medicine and everything is going to be fine. I've got a plan.
So Elisa said that plan called for placing Zahra's remains at different locations throughout Caldwell County. As each day passed, she says that she struggled with whether to go to police, believing the dismemberment may have something to do with Adam Baker's culture in Australia.
How do you believe that?
You don't.
Okay, thank you. I thought it was maybe a little strange ritual that he'd done. For all I know, the Aborigines, I don't know. I just regret not calling sooner. I regret not calling 911. But people do make mistakes, she said.
Holy shit.
Yeah.
Is this the kind of mistake people make?
No.
No, this is a terrible crime. But the evidence made investigators more confident that Adam wasn't involved in the death or the disposal of the body. Some of that evidence would focus on the couple's cell phones. On September 25th, Elisa's phone pinged in the areas of Caldwell County where parts of Zahra's body were later recovered. Police said at that same time, Adam's phone was pinging in Conover, more than 20 miles away, where co-workers and others have said that he was at work. So not only the physical evidence they were able to obtain using the phones, but the evidence obtained from several different witnesses were supporting the statement that Adam gave police and disproving the statement that Elisa was giving.
Right. And after multiple interviews with Adam, the police found out that he had been in and out of the house for more than 2 weeks, and he hadn't seen his own daughter and didn't know she was dead.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I can't go 2 weeks without seeing a kid.
I know. It's not excusable. But he isn't the killer. But,
no.
I mean, it should be a crime, what he did. It should be at least neglect, child abuse neglect.
It should. Now, the state believes that Elisa killed Zahra by striking her on her head. Not enough of Zahra's remains were found to perform an autopsy to test the state's theories about her death. A blood spatter expert was brought in to consult and report his findings, and he said a pattern of 18 tiny blood specks on the wall of Zahra's bedroom suggested that someone had hit Zahra's head repeatedly. The first blow would have cast a few drops here and there. Subsequent blows would strike pooling blood in the original wound, and a sticky mist of blood would have been cast into the air.
So after Zahra was deceased and Elisa calmed down, she needed a way to hide what she had done, of course. She was a woman who was out of shape, and it would have drawn attention if she tried to move Zahra's limp body into her SUV in the middle of the day, of course. So what they think is that she decided a divided-up body would be easier for her to get away with.
Well, sure.
The medical examiner said evidence of two saws or cutting tools was left on Zahra's bones. So what this means is that the first tool may not have worked the way she wanted, so she moved on to a more effective tool. Doing it in the tub would make the most sense for the cleanup. There was someone around that time who'd gone to the house and had a strong odor of bleach in the house.
Yeah.
Yeah. So the state said that Elisa put Zahra's body parts into trash bags and loaded them into her vehicle. Then she drove to the hills and got rid of them. Elisa continued to claim that Adam was responsible, but she pleaded guilty to murder, so no experts were called to testify.
Now, that's interesting to me. If she's claiming that her husband was responsible, but she's going to plead anyway?
Yeah, in the plea, she does say she's responsible. She just won't verbally say it out loud.
Right. After the guilty plea, Caldwell County Department of Social Services revealed that four reports had been received involving Zahra for improper care or for an injurious environment and improper discipline. Now, these have been directed to Child Protective Services, and there is a report back in January 2010. A DSS employee came to the house and interviewed Elisa, Adam, and Zahra. Then 6 days later, the second report came in. Another employee went to the house and spoke with the three family members again, plus the neighbor. Now, after these two interviews, they closed the case, for whatever reason.
Right, right. Well, there was a third report in May 2010, so not long before the death. After joint and separate interviews, the case was closed again. And a fourth report on July 12th, a couple months later, after trying to find the Bakers on July 12th and 13th, Caldwell County DSS contacted Catawba County DSS. And they learned that the Bakers had recently moved to Hickory. So the case was transferred from one county to another. And like you said, I think the moving messes things up because the communication isn't great.
Well, there's always a lag time.
Yeah.
Right?
Right.
Anyway, despite a surprise visit on July 13th and separate interviews and follow-up home visits on July 22nd and August 5th, the case was again closed for lack of evidence.
Police uncovered accusations in their interviews. Elisa's daughter Brittany saw Elisa strike Zahra on the head. They were living in the same trailer at the time, and Brittany's bedroom was next to Zahra's. Brittany saw Zahra crying and saw Elisa hit her on the head. That was the turning point for Brittany when she tried to take Zahra with her and leave.
Yeah. In May 2010, Zahra showed up to school with two black eyes. She had urinated in her clothes at school and was terrified about going home in a different set of clothes. So a school employee washed Zahra's clothing, and she changed back into them before going home.
Angie Foster, who was a friend of Elisa, heard Elisa verbally abusing Zahra in September 2010. This was just around the time of the murder. Elisa was yelling and cursing at Zahra because she had peed in her pants. Now, the Catawba County DSS had a major internal review about how they handled Zahra's case. No one has been terminated, but it was discussed at the North Carolina Child Fatality Review. We don't know if this has made any changes.
No. Then in September 2011, Zahra's stepmother, Elisa Baker, pleaded guilty to murdering Zahra and was sentenced to 18 years in prison. Then in 2013, she was given an additional 10 years for drug-related charges.
Yeah, and this is something that wasn't even brought up earlier. I'm not sure about the drug thing.
No.
I mean, we know that Adam smoked a lot of pot.
But apparently they were dealing.
Mm-hmm.
Then Zahra's skull was found in the woods of North Carolina Road 268 in Caldwell County on April 17, 2012. The skull was about 20 to 30 yards off a dirt road and wasn't buried. A hunter found the skull. He called the police, and the skull was sent to the SBI, and it was then sent to a specialist out of state for further testing. So members of the North Carolina State Bureau of Investigation, the North Carolina Medical Examiner's Office, and the Marshall University Forensic Science Center in Huntington, West Virginia, analyzed the skull and told the attorney's office it belonged to Zahra. However, the analysis did not establish the cause of her death.
Now, Adam was never charged in connection with Zahra's death, but he was in the country illegally and was deported back to Australia.
Yeah, he wasn't charged for anything.
No, he was deported, and he was allowed to take Zahra's remains with him. So that's very sad.
Horrible case.
It is. But it's just, I don't know. I mean, I think if nothing else, it makes us as neighbors, as teachers, as doctors, as whatever we're doing in society, to keep our eyes open, to try and look out for kids in these situations.
And speak up.
Yeah, because obviously Zahra's case is drastic. It's not the usual abuse case because it ended up in such a horrible murder. But I mean, there are thousands of kids who have miserable, abused lives.
There certainly are.
Yeah. So I guess it's the least we can do is try and look out for them.
You're right.
So I want to thank Missy M., who recommended this case to us.
As unsettling as it might have been.
Yes.
Thank you.
Listening to free podcasts is great, isn't it?
It is. I love doing it.
But if you really, really like listening to True Crime Brewery and you've run out of episodes, there are ways to give us some financial support and get access to some members-only full-length episodes. On our website, tygrabber.com, you can sign up to have access to our members-only TCB episodes. You can do this for $3 or $5 a month. You choose how much you want to pay. We have almost 20 extra episodes in the feed now, with new ones being released monthly. This month, we covered Amish serial killer Eli Stutzman and the death of his son Danny, also known as Little Boy Blue. When you sign up, we're going to send you a thank you package as well. If you're a $5 a month subscriber, you'll receive one of our True Crime Brewery snifters, which is Dick's go-to glass for most of the beers he reviews here on the show. Plus, you'll get a sticker, some coasters, whatever good swag we have hanging around the studio. If you contribute $3 a month, you'll also get a sticker and a refrigerator magnet, plus a True Crime Brewery credit card-sized bottle opener. Our new t-shirts are here too, and they're up for sale on our website, tygrabber.com. Check out our new t-shirts or buy one of our classic tees. If you're looking for another podcast to listen to, you could also check out our podcast, Watching ID. And what we do with that is we watch a show on the Investigation Discovery channel, and then we talk about it. Right now, we're covering season 5 of A Crime to Remember, and you don't have to be watching the show in order to enjoy the podcast. We have fun talking about them and sometimes calling them out on things they miss. And one more thing, we're going to be at CrimeCon in Nashville from May 4th to May 6th.
And we are looking forward to that.
Yes, it's our first time, so we're really excited. And we just heard that Dateline correspondent Keith Morrison and the others, Josh, Andrea, and Dennis, will be there. But Keith is my hero, so I'm freaking out just a little. So if you get the time and you want to come hang out with us, you can get 10% off your tickets by using our promo code TCBrewery. You can sign up at crimecon.com and use that promo code TCBrewery to get your discount. Thanks to everyone who sent us feedback. The quality of the feedback is excellent, and we're going to go over some of it now. If you have some for us, send it to us at truecrimebrewery@tygrabber.com. Now our feedback. Dick, I'll let you go with the first one.
This is a timely one. So this is from Tom D., and it covers Child Protective Services. Tom says, "Hi, Jill and Dick. You have always done a good job with cases involving child abuse and child murder. Since I learned that you will be covering the tragic case of Zahra Baker next week, I wanted to get some input to you. I do not work for a state agency, but I am an educator on social sciences and child welfare. And recently I read an article on the difficulties in running an effective child protective services agency, and I want to share a few points for thought and discussion." So he goes on to say, "Public child welfare social work is among the most difficult forms of social work practice. Unlike most other social work practice, child welfare is often confrontational, adversarial, and authoritarian. Yet child welfare social workers, like other social workers, came to the profession to help ease the burden of others. Now the consequence is that the turnover rate among child health workers is among the highest in the field and far exceeds other professions. Turnover in child welfare has been estimated at 30 to 40% annually. So this means that an entire child welfare staff can turn over in less than 3 years. Almost every state and county reports difficulty in recruiting competent replacement staff. So there are many causes for turnover in child welfare: high caseloads, high workloads, low salaries, and insufficient training. There's also administrative burdens, secondary trauma, and just getting burned out. So adding additional pressure to child welfare workers and administrators is the finding that in one jurisdiction, 90% of child protective staff had experienced verbal threats, 30% had been physically attacked, and 13% had been threatened with weapons. Also, child welfare salaries are significantly below salaries for employees in safer and more supportive environments, such as teachers, school social workers, nurses, and public health social workers. Likewise, recruitment of qualified candidates is a constant challenge and is considered one of the major problems facing child welfare administrators. Please don't see these as excuses, but hopefully the facts can lead to improvements."
Yeah, thanks, Tom.
We've had times when we talk about how Child Protective Services has fallen down on the follow-up of things.
Yeah, but usually I don't think that's because of the employee. I think it's the overall system.
It's a daunting task.
Yes.
And I think Tom presents a good explanation for some of the things that can go on with that.
Well, just the nature of families with children, it's a tough area to get into because people are absolutely threatened if you're trying to say that they're not a good parent. Because, you know, most people think they're a good parent, even when they're terrible.
They do. Yeah.
Even Elisa seemed to keep saying what a great mother she was.
Yeah.
I think she really believed that.
I guess so. I mean, I think she might have also been doing that for the benefit of the interrogators.
But absolutely. But I think most people don't think they're the bad guy.
No, they don't. I agree.
And she probably thinks, oh, well, it's just a shame that I lost my temper and killed her, but I was a really good mother up until then.
Yeah,
right?
Except for that tiny little problem.
Right. But, I mean, it sounds crazy, but I really think that's how the mind works.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it was a well-written, thoughtful letter.
Yeah. I think a lot of it comes down to funding. I mean, if you're saying that teachers and public health social workers are making more money, you're not making much money because they're way underpaid.
Right. Yeah. And they're making way more money.
Yeah,
so
right.
They're way underpaid.
Way underpaid. It's another example of how we just make all this talk about how important children are, but we don't really put everything into it. I don't want to go off on a tangent, but the government spends so much money on the military and so little on families and children.
Well,
they don't even want them to have health care.
Besides that, the whole thing about guns.
It's definitely something that we all need to think about and change some things in this country.
That's for sure.
Yeah. Okay.
Your turn.
I have a case suggestion from Laura W., and she left this on our TCB fan discussion page on Facebook. Hey, Jill, I would love to hear your take on a case out of the Tar Heel State. I'm pasting a link about Blanche Taylor Moore, who's been on death row in North Carolina for nearly 3 decades.
Wow. Long time.
Yes. Elizabeth Montgomery, Bewitched, portrayed her perfectly in the TV movie Preacher's Daughter. Moore was convicted of the poisoning murder of ex-partner Raymond Reed, but poisoned many family members. North Carolina seems to have proclivity for black widows who murder via poison. Moore is often mentioned along with Velma Barfield, whose crimes were similar. The women's lives and crimes were comparable, childhood trauma, etc., with Barfield being executed. In fact, doing a cast on both would be fascinating. Sorry for being so long-winded, but that's just kind of how I roll. LOL. So I just looked this up a little bit, and Blanche Moore, her father was an alcoholic who forced her into prostitution to pay his gambling debts. And she was known to switch from quoting scripture to some sexually explicit topics in the same breath. Her father died in 1966, and the cause of his death was reported to be a heart attack. In 1952, Blanche married a veteran and furniture restorer. They had 2 children, and he also died. She began working at a Kroger, and she began having an affair with Raymond Reed, the manager of the store where she worked. He died in 1971, and as with her father, the cause of death was initially reported as a heart attack. After his death in 1971, she and her manager began dating publicly, and by 1985, that relationship had gone south. And she began to date the Kroger regional manager. In 1985, she met Reverend Dwight Moore, the new pastor of her church, who was divorced, and they began dating. He would say while they were dating that she asked him to get some arsenic-based ant killer for her. She married again, and that husband died of poisoning. So it's been speculated that she may have poisoned several others. All those in question died mysteriously, showing some signs of arsenic poisoning. So she's now on death row, and there's a book and a movie about these crimes, so I think that would make a good episode.
That sounds interesting, doesn't it?
Well, the Black Widow thing is always interesting.
Yeah, you like that.
That's a fun one for me.
You like those women killers.
Well, it's just because they're so plotted out with the poisoning. It's really a cold-blooded way to kill someone, and often it's a painful way to die, some of these poisonings.
Arsenic is horrible.
Arsenic?
You're sicker than shit.
And antifreeze is bad.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that would definitely be True Crime Brewery fodder.
Okay. So I have another case suggestion from Mark W., which I'll talk about it, but yeah, we got to do this one.
Oh, okay.
So Mark says this could be worth a future episode. It's really disturbing in the way it all played out. He says there's a discussion to be had about concussions, steroids, and prescription drugs.
Oh, yeah, you'd like to do this one.
And then the strange occurrences like the deaths being announced on Wikipedia before the bodies were found by the police.
Wow.
And the IP address for the announcement being traced back to WWE headquarters. Then there's the almost impossible physics of Benoit's own suicide. The stretch of time between the two murders and his own suicide, the text messages, the alcohol found next to his body, despite there being no alcohol in his system, and the media coverage.
A lot to it.
So we looked it up. Over a three-day period between June 22nd and June 25th, 2007, Chris Benoit, a 40-year-old veteran professional wrestler employed by World Wrestling Entertainment, WWE, killed his wife, Nancy Benoit, strangled their 7-year-old son, Daniel, and then hanged himself. Now, autopsy results showed that Benoit's wife was murdered first as she was bound at the feet and wrists and died of asphyxiation on Friday. She was found wrapped in a towel and with blood under her head, although Fayette County District Attorney Scott Ballard reported no other signs of a struggle.
So where'd the blood come from?
Right. Then the couple's son, Daniel Christopher Benoit, also died of asphyxia, apparently killed as he lay in bed on Saturday morning, so the day after.
Wow.
Then on Sunday evening, Benoit died by suicide in his weight room when he used a weightlifting machine to break his own neck. That's grisly.
Yeah.
He placed copies of the Bible alongside the bodies of his wife and son, as well as a third Bible on his weightlifting machine. Now, since Benoit's suicide, numerous explanations for his actions have been proposed, including brain damage, steroid abuse, and a failing marriage. The incident led to numerous media accounts and a federal investigation into steroid abuse in professional wrestling.
Which must have been rampant because those people are really muscular.
Yeah.
Yeah. I remember this a little bit.
I remember when this happened. I remember kind of the story, but not the details.
Because it's a sad story, of course. But I think his son had some kind of disability, didn't he?
I don't remember that.
I think he did.
Okay.
Unless I'm remembering the wrong case, I think he did. And a lot of this was put on steroid abuse, but also the whole concussion brain damage thing.
Yeah.
But I haven't heard anything about his autopsy, so that would be something I'd really like you to read and look into.
We'll check it out. Okay. So we're going to do it?
I believe we can. I mean, it'll be a ways out. But
Sometime in the summer, early fall, we'll do it.
Yeah, I'd like to do it. And, you know, sometimes other things can be bumped off and things that we're really interested in are put in their place, so you never know.
Okay.
I guess to me, it depends on what you find in the autopsy.
I'll check it out.
Okay. Because we know Aaron Hernandez, is that his name, the football player?
Right.
His autopsy showed a terrible brain. He had severe brain damage.
It did.
Yeah. So that might be something to do also. Or just do an episode on head trauma in sports and the things that have happened.
Well, that'd be a tougher one.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can't establish, at least at this point, cause and effect.
Really? No?
No.
Okay. I definitely see a connection just as a layperson.
Well, yes, there's a connection, but that doesn't mean there's a cause and effect.
But I'm just wondering, there are how many cases of this kind of stuff have we seen over the past even 10 years? A lot. We've seen a lot of suicides, a lot of murders.
But no one has been able to establish that the brain damage causes
the behavior.
The behavior.
Right.
So.
Okay, but there must be studies on it that we could look into.
I'm sure there are.
I'm sure there are lots of studies.
Yep.
All right.
All right, team.
Well, thanks, Dick. This was a good episode. I appreciate you doing it with me. I know it's always difficult when we talk about a child, especially with this horrific of a crime, but I think some of these discussions are just important to have.
Well, if for nothing else, and to make people more aware of what's going on.
Yeah.
Right?
Right, and to maybe live their own lives a little bit more aware.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like we said, if something bothers you, talk to somebody about it.
That's right. Okay. Well, just a reminder, if you have feedback for us, you can send it to truecrimebrewery@tygrabber.com. You can share it on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram. We also have our True Crime Brewery fan discussion page, which I mentioned earlier on Facebook, where there are over 1,000 people now sharing information not only from our cases, but from all kinds of crimes. So it's really interesting. We get a lot of updates there on crimes we've covered before. It's a good place to find that kind of stuff.
It is.
Yeah.
I like doing it.
Okay. Well, thank you for joining us at the Quiet End today, and we will talk to you next week.
And we'll see you at Open Mic Night. Bring your best songs.
Okay. Bye-bye.
Bye.